Hey everybody, thank you for tuning in to another episode of the Art of Intervention Project, where we're creating a resource for families and professionals around the idea and the process and reality of interventions. And today I get the privilege of interviewing David Marion. We've known each other for a few years, and he's definitely one of the guys out in the field that is making a difference in families and in people's lives, especially in our crazy time today with this coronavirus going on. So give us a quick intro of who you are, and we'll just kind of dive into interventions and get busy.
Thanks, Rob. I'm Dave Marion. I'm an interventionist. I'm a life recovery coach. I'm a guy in long-term recovery. I'm a guy on the front line fighting addiction. I've done some pretty neat things over the course of my recovery. I worked on the opioid stewardship bill in the state of Minnesota, the first bill to pass to hold some of these pharmaceutical companies accountable for the mess they created. Testified in front of a Senate subcommittee hearing on this epidemic, and we passed the first opioid stewardship bill in the state of Minnesota, and 12 other states are following our lead right now. So, very involved. I'm an author, wrote my first book, collaborated with my ex-wife, Addiction Rescue, the No BS Guide to Recovery. And hang on, I'm going to get you a plug on that.
There you go.
Let me show you the book.
Let's do it. Let's do it. Well, definitely, as he's grabbing the book, a thought leader in our industry and just a guy out there making things happen, as you can tell from his own intro right there. And resources are what we're all about here. So the resource you're getting to share with us that you were a part of, Writing Day with Your Ex, which is a cool story. So there it is. All right, addiction. What is it? Addiction? I can't see it.
Rescue.
Addiction Rescue, you guys.
The No BS Guide to Recovery.
I love it. That's what this is about. This is why we're doing this, right? We're kind of taking the cutting through the BS and just moving forward on the reality of the situations we're dealing with. And as an interventionist, people say, like, well, what's an intervention? Or I want to do an intervention. How do you define what an intervention is from your point of view?
Intervention is where loved ones come together because somebody close to them is struggling with destructive behaviors, addictive behaviors, and they don't know what to do. So they usually end up calling a professional interventionist. Unfortunately, I am the last call, not the first call, meaning that once the family does come together, we figure out a plan, how to move forward and get the loved one the help that they need. It is a several step process to an intervention. And I don't know if we want to get into that or we can get into it later. But, obviously the family reaches out to me or a treatment center that they contract with, and they'll call me and say the family is looking for some guidance, some suggestions, possibly an intervention. I'll meet the contact person and I'll go over a list of questions that I ask. You know, I want to assess the situation to find out where we're at, what they've tried so far, and has the, you know, person ever thought about recovery, been in recovery, gone to a treatment center prior to. Then what happens is I'm going to have the family, probably no more than 6 or 7 people I like in an intervention, not including myself and the loved one who is there. We're going to write letters to the loved one prior to the intervention process. We will meet in a pre-intervention process without the loved one. And we'll go over the letters. The letters, real simply, the first paragraph might be about what their son or daughter was like before they started using drugs and alcohol. I want to use specific examples at that time as well. Remember the time we were chasing frogs or fishing, or we went to grandma's on Easter and we had the best time, laughing, belly laughing. Really meant to tug on the heartstrings of the loved one at that time. Second paragraph talks about what has happened since drugs and alcohol have entered your life, how you've changed and it's changed you. And specific examples again, the loneliness, the isolation, missing events, being withdrawn, losing jobs, DWIs, whatever they might be. It's not meant as a shaming process or really on a confrontational level. This is done strictly on love, care, and support. Obviously, there's two types of interventions. There's a surprise and an invitational. I'm more of the surprise intervention, this guy. The third paragraph says, please reclaim your life. Accept this gift of treatment that we are offering you today and go to treatment with David. We go through the intervention process. We do a role playing. I make sure all the seats in the intervention are set in a specific way. I'm not going to have the mom who's the enabler and the codependent sitting right next to the loved one where he could look at her and say, mom, get me out of this. So I'm usually going to put someone in there to block them. And I position it in a way where the loved one is furthest from the door.
Yeah, so the internet's a little slow today. People kind of, you know, it's what goes on every now and then. So it's a little choppy, but that's okay because your voice sounds clear. But you're kind of like this maestro orchestrating all the pieces of the intervention and making just kind of a symphony out of what's happening in the room.
Absolutely. And I take total control of the intervention in there. I've seen families try to do their own interventions and they've gone awry. The important part of the control of the intervention is done in a way that we are all seem to have the same primary purpose, to work together to get the loved one the help and the treatment that they need. So we'll read a letter, I'll let it resonate with them. There's no sidebar really talking at this time. I'm doing the only talking in between the letters. I'm talking about disease of alcoholism, drug addiction, the path era, things like that. My experience, strength, and hope that I have shared with many, and it begins to resonate. You know, after the letters are read, I've had situations where we had a guy in, Omaha, Nebraska, vice president of a big data corporation there. He ended up saying after the intervention, looked at everybody and said, thank you everybody for coming. I'm not going to treatment. Get out of my house. Everybody got out but me. He grabbed two beers, went in the refrigerator, and he headed upstairs. I looked at his wife and I said, let me go up there alone with him. 20 minutes later, I yelled down to his wife, lean him on up and pack his bags. He's coming to treatment with me. What'd you tell him? I told him the truth. And when a man or woman begins to hear the truth for the first time, they thirst for more of it. And it was an interesting conversation that we did have. I told him, you don't have to come with me today, but you do have to come with me to the cemetery. Because your two young boys that you have, 6 and 8, I'm going to help you write a legacy letter. Or maybe an obituary, if there is a legacy that you're ready to leave. I said, but on the way there, we might as well stop at the police station because you're a danger to society, you're a danger to the neighborhood, and a danger to your family driving around drunk like this. I said, the problem is that they'll probably put you in the psych ward for 9 months to a year minimum stint. She's looking at 30 days in treatment with you. I don't know, 9 months to a year. He looked at me, he said, fine, pack my bags.
Yeah, well, but it's meeting people where they are a lot of times too, right? And you're a guy that has a story that you can share with people because you know addiction. You've seen it both sides. I mean, you even said right before you started this call that, again, this is going to give people hope in this conversation, and we'll get back to this. But what is unique about your living situation right now?
The uniqueness thing is that I'm living with my two daughters. We're quarantined together in Minneapolis, Minnesota, who are 24 and 22. And that might not seem strange to many, but the last time I was living with my two daughters was in junior high, pre-prison. Before I went to prison, I was living with my daughters. Fast forward 12 years later, I've changed and they've changed. There's a lot of adjustments that have to be made, right?
Yeah.
This is, you know, you can probably relate that this lockdown has people just up in arms. I was locked in solitary confinement for 3 weeks.
This is without a refrigerator. Right.
Yeah. I mean, we get to understand it, you know, and perspective we put on this, and it's okay. It's just for a time.
Yep. I think I froze. There we go. You're right. It is all about perspective. And for those listening to this video years down the road, we're talking about this coronavirus COVID-19 pandemic that's in our country right now, around the world, and being stuck at home. I can't say stuck, because as you and I can relate, being free in our own home with our family, where there was a time that we weren't, is a huge blessing. And so that's really great, because I know I've interviewed you before in my podcast, Beyond the Bars Radio, and you got to share your whole entire story. And so seeing where you are now today is amazing. And our times are changing. And during like the whole intervention process, I want to, like, have you noticed before that, man, this guy, there's no addiction here. The family's just off. Has there ever been a time where it's been like, maybe this guy really isn't as bad as they say the person was?
Yes, I did an intervention in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. And the family was real concerned. We had met prior to, told me about how much this individual was using. And at the intervention, interestingly enough, I wanted to do a drug test on him because he said he hadn't been using. He hadn't been using. He had some real mental health issues, clinical depression, real anxiety, fear, some psychosis. Now, obviously, the drug use that he had been doing months prior to amplified all this and exasperated it to the point where the family was out of control, not knowing what it was, blaming it on the drugs. And often we see the co-occurring disorder, the dual diagnosis, of mental health and addiction. There's not a lot of facilities that really know how to treat both. Now, obviously, I often hear, my daughter, my son, my loved one is really depressed. I said, usually when we're using every day, we're really depressed. What I've seen, though, is that once they sober up, the depression and fear seem to dissipate. Unless if it's symptomatic depression, absolutely. Clinical depression is a little different, but for the most part, it's symptomatic. I know I was depressed. I wasn't the happiest guy in the world ever using every day. Yeah. You weren't either. Right?
Yeah, exactly.
There's other stuff going on.
Yeah, well, there's always this underlying part, and you talk about facilities there. So when you mentioned the intervention process before, and you're talking about facilities and the pre-planning and everything, how do you personally determine if a treatment center is a good treatment center or not?
That's a really good question. I've gone on a lot of professional weekends at different facilities. I'm constantly reading on facilities. And for me, it's important to meet a patient when I'm at a facility. I can see the culture of what's happening there. It's kind of, I take the temperature and see the temperament of this person. Now, if they're there 3 days, it's going to be a lot different than someone in their fourth week.
Right.
Change is imminent. We will see the change in people, right? And often that we've heard when we first come into this deal, when we're using, it's like a smoke bomb went off. No one wants to be around us. But after a few weeks, we begin to look different. It's almost as if we're really tapped into the recovery thing. There's an illuminating spirit that we walk with, that people will look at you and say, Rob, did you get a haircut? I see the clarity in your eyes when we speak, and they don't know what it is. But that difference is magnified to guys like us because we understand they are on this spiritual journey, and they began to tap into a piece of it. They don't know what it is or what they're feeling, but they like it.
Yeah, when you start clearing out the substances, we start feeling a lot better and we want more. So we go into this journey of, hey, I have this addiction, this dependency on a chemical, or whether it's shopping or gambling or pornography, or addiction is it can be a broad term, but it's you know, something that we're using to escape of whatever's going on in our world. And people go to a treatment center and they start getting help. And what advice do you give, or how do you work with the family that is now at home with their loved one that's now in a facility getting better, if you will? What do you do with family members along the way?
As you well know, addiction is a family disease, and the recovery is a journey together. The person with the substance use disorder has been afflicted, and the family has been affected. And how that has affected the family is interesting. It shows in different dynamics the brokenness of the family. What has to happen is, just because Johnny went to treatment, the mom, who is the codependent, maybe the enabler, or the whole life, that's the role she played. When Johnny comes out and Johnny is beginning to become different, not needing as much as he did, all of a sudden, these people who haven't worked a program in their life begin to realize their title, their place, their identity is lost. My job was taking care of him. Now he's taking care of himself. And I often say it's similar to a stuck pig in a pen, right? They don't know what to do and how to get out. The family needs to take care of themselves, whether it's Al-Anon, whether it's seeing a therapist, whether it's tapping into some type of spiritual program. Because I've often seen many people relapse because the family has come back after 3 weeks or 4 weeks and said, "You haven't changed at all. You're the same person you are." It's asking a lot. Listen, we've been using for years and years. This is a process. It's not an event that happens overnight. And as long as we get on that path, we have a chance. So the family has to get on the path also.
Yeah. So there's not only the loved one that has substance abuse that's in recovery, but also the family. And the word recovery also is another broad term, right? Like, we're in recovery, or we're in the process of recovery. What does recovery look like for you in your own personal life?
It's three components, recovery, for me. It's mind, it's body, and spirit. So what that means is that I get to work on myself mentally, emotionally, physically, and spiritually. But more importantly, what I put into my body represents how I'm going to feel. I know that if I want to start feeling good about myself, I have to stop doing the things that make me feel bad. For me, that's fast food. So I eliminate the fast food in my life. I eat healthy. I try to eat organic food, you know, as much as I can. And I try to make the right choices. That's a component that I really work on. I exercise. I try to do something every day. I try to do whatever it might be, if it's lifting weights, if it's push-ups, if it's going to the track. I have to do something every day. And for my recovery, I have to do something as far as the spiritual program, which means I'll start off with my morning meditations. I have to feel, how do I center myself to let myself know that I don't have to drive the bus. I just have to get my big ass on the bus, that I am not in control. You know, and usually the way I wake up in the morning, I have a little post-it note on my bathroom mural. So first thing in the morning, I come rolling out after I go to the bathroom, I look in the post-it note and it says, "Dear David, I won't be needing your help today. Thanks anyway. Love, God." Like, oh yeah, that's it.
Nice.
Kind of centers you early, you know?
Oh yeah. Yeah. It's a great reminder right there for sure.
Yeah.
You know, and it's funny. We talk about, you're talking about the bus, right? And getting on the bus. And not too long ago, you and I were traveling together down in Florida, visiting a treatment center together, great treatment center down there. And it was fun. Cause I joke about, like, here comes Dave in an intervention, right? And like, I'm not a small guy. I'm 6 feet tall and a pretty strong guy built, you know. You're, how tall are you?
6'5".
Yeah, 6'5". You come in and it's just like, okay, I'm going to listen to this guy, because you come in and it's like but it's like you bring this presence, not only in size, but your stature and the way that you like take control of a room and the way you love people and the way you just invite them in. Like, you make them feel warm and fuzzy. And you mentioned in the beginning, this is not a shaming process. This is a place of love and concern. And the more we can love and concern, or show love and concern for our loved ones and the families, it's such a healing vibe that gets put into that environment.
You're 100% right. And thank you for that. It's, you know, guys like us have a passion to help another person. If I was doing this to make money, I'd be in the wrong business.
Right.
Because I probably do more service work in a week than, I mean, it's, you know, I don't know how many times I've gone out and helped people just for the satisfaction of seeing them to save a life. The way I look at it, I'm on borrowed time. I should have been dead a long time ago. You know, they rolled the dice and said, you're on house money, man. I'll give you one more shot, but you better make the most of it.
Yeah.
Because the best friends, I saw a picture recently when I was 21 years old, down at the University of South Florida in Tampa, my two best friends in life, we had gone out for my 21st birthday and we're in a limousine. And I looked at the picture recently, both of them have overdosed and died. I say, wow, it was no different. Why is he keeping me here? Obviously, there's a reason I'm supposed to be here. We've often heard it said the two greatest days of our life, Rob, the day we're born and the day we realize why we're born.
Mm.
Until I really got into recovery years ago, I found my purpose. And once I found my purpose, I found my gift. And that is the greatest place to be, to know when I wake up every day, I have a purpose and I know what my gift is. And all I had to do is get here is drink everything, smoke anything, you know, shoot anything and end up in federal prison for years to realize it. But thank God I did realize it. You know, I was one of the few fortunate ones that didn't die like yourself, right? And the appreciation that we have on a daily basis is beyond the wildest of my imagination.
And you went through all of that to get where you are, what you do now. And so you talk about feeling called and you're definitely in the right place. That's for darn sure. And you are a transformed man from me knowing your entire story and where you are now. How do you relate to the word like transformation in someone's recovered life? Like maybe some families you've worked with or an individual, but what does that word transformation mean to you for others?
I break it down to the spiritual principle. What is spirituality, right? For me, it's patience, it's tolerance, it's understanding. It's sympathy, it's empathy, it's care. When I was using, there was not one of those in the equation. Because the true three principles for me living in recovery are humility, responsibility, and accountability. When I was using, there was no humility. I was a grandiose son of a gun, right? I wasn't accountable to anyone and I was never responsible, never where I said I was gonna be. So it all transforms. When we begin to look at the perspective of life, Rob, it changes the way we view our own life. Probably a year or so ago, I was in a supermarket here. And there was three people in front of me. There was a woman behind me who was getting quite agitated that they had such lines in this grocery store. And I'm listening to her go ballistic behind me. Why don't they hire more people? This is insane. I can't believe they're making us wait. And I just look up and say, oh boy, here comes another one of your tests, I'm thinking, right? And she's going on and on. Finally, I turned to her and I said, lady, if you would love to go ahead of me, feel free. I've waited in lines of 250 to 300 people to eat three times a day. She says, where were you? I said, federal prison. She says, she jumps up. And I said, do you believe that things happen for a reason? Mm. Right? And maybe we're supposed to be right where we're supposed to be. Maybe you're supposed to be taught patience, tolerance, understanding. And I'm having a conversation with this lady and she's listening to me.
Mm.
All of a sudden, the line begins to move. I said, lady, please go ahead of me. She says, no, I need to be right here. Thank you.
And if we just loving people better where we are instead of feeding into the chaos, Yeah. Especially now. I mean, sit there, think of the panic people feel now. And you had mentioned earlier, which I think is actually a cool thing to touch on, because our times are changing a little bit. And the intervention process is changing right now because people still need help. So you've become creative in that moment and mentioned that you're getting ready to take on kind of like your first virtual intervention.
Yes.
What's that going to look like?
It's going to be tough. It's going to be daunting. It's going to be interesting. But as long as we exude the same passion and desire to help this person, that's what's going to shine through. This is the new normal. We don't know what it looks like, right? We don't know where we're headed, but we know where we're at today. We know that the way they're vetting people, into treatment centers today, my responsibility, if I do an intervention in person, I have to take the temperature of that person prior to. Once we get to the facility outside, I have to take their temperature again. I have to wait for the admission process and the assessment process when I drop them off. And then if they don't get accepted in there because they might be sick, I have to be willing to transport them back. So it's no more pull up at the curb, see ya, good luck in treatment kind of thing, right? There's a lot more that's going into this right now because they're really very cautious. And so we don't know where it's going to end up, right? It might end up virtual. We don't know right now. But for this, we have to be creative and become a chameleon and adjust and adapt to these situations that prevail.
Yeah, so in the beginning of our talk, you talked about, and the person says, okay, and you said, hey, why don't you just come with Dave right now, and we'll go get some help. What does going with Dave look like?
Going with Dave today is still, I have to be present to bring them or one of my transport guys. But I usually do a lot of it. I love to meet the person one-on-one. I love traveling across the country with somebody because we never know what's going to happen. And I trust myself in that situation. I believe that, I'll tell you a story. I'm traveling with a person cross country, coming up to the facility in Minnesota, which I use a lot, Hazelton Betty Ford Foundation. Fabulous facility. I love what they do. I love everything that they're standing for. And I have a personal relationship with them because in 1989, I came crawling through their doors there.
Wow.
A broken man. We're about 33,000 feet in the air. And I do one of my quick little nods, like my dog has a tail that spins. I was doing my quick little put my head down, try to catch a quick nap. I wake up and I see the patient I'm traveling with is going into withdrawal.
Oh, my gosh.
At 33,000 feet, I'm thinking, oh, my God, he's sweating. He's possibly going into some type of seizure. Immediately, I hit the airline stewardess thing. I said, ma'am, screaming for her. She says, what can I get you? I said, 2 shots of whiskey and a beer. And I gave this man both shots of whiskey and he drank the beer. And it's almost as if he came back to life. Mm. We don't know where that's going to happen. And I don't want other people to be put in that situation. I feel more comfortable with myself doing that at 33,000 feet and having to rely on somebody else. So...
thank God you were there. And that is so important to have a professional transport that you had the wisdom to be on the plane with this person, because we don't know. And can people travel by themselves if it's a direct flight and you walk them to the gate and they get on and someone picks them up at the end? Sure. But they can also dip off to a bar and disappear from there to getting out. So the importance of not only doing transports and with your team of transports, but actually going and getting the loved one there safely has got to give the family some comfort and peace too.
Oh, absolutely. And I think that's, listen, if they would have told me back then, jump on this plane, and just head out there. Well, good luck. I was so broken at the time I was ready. But on that flight, let me tell you, I don't think there was a time that stewardess walked back and forth that I didn't have a drink.
Yeah.
Because I knew it was coming to an end. And that's it, you know. Today's different, though. I've seen many runners, and there's always a lot of runners. I was doing an intervention in Connecticut recently. And it was an interesting scenario. Big Italian family. What does an Italian family bring to an intervention?
Energy.
Food. Food. I've never seen they had pasta fagioli and ravioli and my God. I said, I've never seen this. Do we eat before the intervention, during it? Long story short, we're going through the intervention, and the young man, 31-year-old heroin addict, gets up halfway through this intervention, and he runs out, and he's foaming at the mouth, and he can't talk. And the family wants to get up and run after. I said, nope, I will go with him, please. The mom is yelling for him to get back in here. I said, please allow me this. And I go upstairs, I follow him out. He goes into his into the parking lot, opens up his front door of his car, grabs a cigarette. Still foaming, cannot talk. Lights the cigarette up. Now he goes into his trunk, opens up the trunk. My first thought is baseball bat, three iron, you know. What's a guy been hit by sledgehammers? What's it going to be today? Yeah. And you know what he pulls out, Rob? A pad of paper. And he begins to write. And I said, Mikey, start, get it out, Mikey. And he can't talk, and I see he's fuming. Smoke's coming out of his ear. And he begins to write, and I say, keep writing, get it all out. Get it out, Mikey. Mikey keeps writing and writing. And finally, he's done. And he rips the page out, and he hands it to me. And it's about the physical and sexual abuse he had as a young boy that no one in that room knew about. No one did. And I said, give me the lighter, Mikey. After we read it, I lit it on fire in the parking lot. Mm. I said, it's over, Mikey. You don't have to keep living the way you were living and feeling the way you were feeling anymore. This is released. It's gone. I said, come here, give me a hug. And he gave me a hug. And I said, can I get your car keys too? If you want to leave, I'll give them to you. Sure enough, he hands me his car keys. And we go back into the intervention. And then finally, we escort him to a facility in Connecticut that was on the methadone program that he had. He was doing so much heroin and so much methadone, he had to come down off it. But great facility. And, you know, I was telling that story. I recently spoke in St. Paul to the St. Paul police, the mayor, and the firefighters. And I said to the firefighters, when I lit it on fire, I was made sure that I got it out right there, guys. Don't worry.
Yeah, that's all you need is an accidental car blowing up in the parking lot. That would be a story in itself. So, well, I just think the work you do is awesome. The way you approach it is great. Like you said, you look at these approaches from, you know, a surprise or an invitational. Sometimes there's a fit for each one of them. A lot of times it's just we need to get in and we need to get this person help. And sometimes there's probably times when you feel like you need to slow it down, right? And maybe those, so it's a variety of ways to help families and look at it, but your approach is unique. You're a real guy. You've been through the fires and storms yourself. You know, you love people well. And as you continue to go forward and helping people, and people want to reach out to you and say, hey, how do I use Dave? How do I connect with this guy? How do they connect with you?
Well, they can reach me at my website is thelifereverycoach.com. My email is david@thelifereverycoach.com. And my phone number is 612-849-7509. Recently, I got called down to North Carolina by a woman who her sister, who lived in upstate New York, had heard me speak at a convention. And I asked her, how did you get a hold of me? She said, my sister had heard you speak a few years ago. I started following you on social media. And she reached out to me through social media. We connected and we did the intervention. I flew down to North Carolina. It's amazing the people that we meet and the walks that we go. So each and every one of us who are fortunate enough to get this thing called recovery have a responsibility, right? To be as big as we can and take this thing out there. What I mean by out there is a great indication of how is my program working. I need to check in, right, to see how I'm doing. I got to see what's going on the highways, right? When the guy and the gal in the car cut me off, am I still willing to chase him down and separate his head from his shoulders?
Mm-hmm.
What do I say? Well, wait a second. Maybe the woman in the vehicle is pregnant and they're trying to get to the hospital, right?
Yeah.
It begins to diminish a lot of this stuff when I move from an irrational thought to a rational belief. What's happening in my living room now that I'm with my two daughters? How are we getting along? Is this stuff that has to be talked about? This is all new to both of us, all three of us, excuse me. So there's going to have to be some change implemented because the old way is different. That was years ago living with them. What's happening in my office with my colleagues and how am I getting along with the people around? That's all indicative of what's happening in my life today
mm-hmm.
and the program that I choose to work, right? If it's a spiritual program, you know, listen, there's a lot of, you said about treatment centers. There's a lot of treatment centers out there. Some use a 12-step model. Some use a holistic therapeutic approach. Everyone has a different approach, but you have to get on a path. Somewhere along the line, you have to get on a path. I'm dealing with a young man, Rob, 15-year-old boy. I got a call from his mom 6 months ago. This young man was, at 13 years old, he was a star Division I looked at hockey player. At 13, he was so outstanding, he was getting the highest of D1 looks. He came home one night, and his father, his coach, and his best friend, who his dad was, committed suicide, and he found him.
Oh my gosh.
For the last 2 years, this A student young man has been on a run and has been in and out of juvie hall. I recently met with him and we connected immediately because I know how to connect with a guy like that. Usually they're begging to be heard. And once, you know, we begin to tell our story, somewhere along the line, it resonates with them. I don't pretend to be any better because I have a few more days of recovery than them. I understand I'm the same person as him, and I let them know that. And I met him in a jail facility where the mom and I were escorted into a private room to meet him. And sure enough, walks in a sheriff that I've never met before, a woman. She looks over at the mom and looks at the young man and points at them and said, you better listen to this guy. I've heard him speak recently and he knows what he's talking about.
Wow.
What?
That is, well, it doesn't matter when you share what you share because you just gave two great examples there of someone from like, say 6 months ago to 2 years from now or 2 years ago that heard what you said and they remembered you. They remembered your story. And it was just a matter of the right timing for them to hear it.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, sometimes it resonates with people differently in different places. And, you know, I'm blessed to know that, you know, I have a message. We all have a message. It's how we dispense that message, right? Because all we're looking for is someone to dispense a message on how to dismember and dismantle the power of this obsession. How do we disrupt it is part of the message that I am portraying to them today.
Yeah.
That if I act upon these obsessions, I don't let them in my mind. I have to shut it down and disrupt it immediately.
You definitely do. You know, timing, just everything and learning this wisdom and hearing, and you know, from as an interventionist and recovery coach, you know, myself, and I throw my business cards. I just put them out everywhere. I put them at cash registers, wherever. I put them in front of urinals. you know, just whatever, to just someone's going to pick it up. And people do call, and whenever it's the right timing. And so I just want to encourage viewers, listeners, people reading, you know, because this is a multimedia art of intervention project, right? We're getting this out through video like this. And, you know, I know our video was a little choppy in the beginning, so thanks for those that stuck through it. You know, now we have like 100% signals on both of our ends, you know, but the clarity of the message is there and the power of the message is there. And I just, you know, keep, as we say in the recovery sometimes, you know, it's like trudging the road of happy destiny. Trudge is doing it together, you know, and unifying and being in connection and community. And man, I just say congrats on your book and your story and all you're doing up there in Minnesota. When you say hockey in Minnesota, I mean, those go hand in hand, right?
Right, exactly.
Yeah, like the hockey capital of the world practically. And, you know, and the fact you wrote a book with your ex-wife and now you're in the house right now with your daughters and quarantine because of the coronavirus and making just the best and doing a virtual intervention. I mean, you just keep adapting to what's going on in the times. And that's what, to me, that's what transformation recovery is all about, adaptation.
Oh, I completely agree, Rob. I do. And thank you. And thank you for doing what you're doing. Also giving a voice to this, because I think with recovery comes a voice. We all have a voice. And sometimes some of the toughest of the tough that it takes us so long to recover become the loudest voices for recovery. Mm. And I know I wasn't coming in here so easily. I came in kicking and screaming. You know, they hogtied me, threw me in there and said, okay. And I wasn't ready, you know. And, you know, part of my story is that I was a first generation prescription guy. Mm. And I have dealt with a lot of the ramifications of that. Hence my fight on the opioid epidemic has been so powerful because I was lied to for years.
Right.
Not knowing. The first prescription that I ever got, 180 pills, calling the doctor immediately and say, doc, you're never going to believe it. I'm going to the bathroom. I opened up a pill bottle. They all spilled down.
Yeah.
David, I'll write you another one.
It happened again, by the way. I got buttery fingers. Help. Yeah.
Exactly.
Well, you've definitely come out of the other side of it. You're doing awesome. And just thanks for being a part of the project here. And we'll definitely catch you on another episode or another talk later on. And just keep the good fight up and helping families and individuals get on the right path.
Thanks so much, Rob. Always great to see you. And it was fun down in Florida. And it's great connecting always with you. You're doing great things as well. I appreciate you.
Thanks, man. We'll be in touch.
Thank you. Take care.